So our next challenge is second order ordinary differential equations. We shall focus on linear ones. Now that is not in one episode affair, it's rather a multi-stage project. And indeed only in chapter 5 we shall really learn the techniques of how to finish a solution. That is, in chapter 5 we learn how to construct the essential building blocks that we need to form the general solution of a second order differential equation. Now I've mentioned it, there's building blocks, and it is indeed possible to form a general solution out of only a few building blocks. And that is what chapter 3 is about. So that is needed as a motivation if you start chapter 5, because in chapter 5 calculations are considerable. So you better know that you're finished when you're done with those. And that's what chapter 3 is about. So chapter 3 is the theory, second order linear differential equations, what the solution spaces, what the general solutions look like, how they are, what the structure is, how they are constructed, that they are constructed out of building blocks indeed, and how that works and why that works. So I'm already suggesting that chapter 3 is kind of theoretical, and therefore I want to give a thought on that and make an advice of how to study this particular chapter. Because many subjects in mathematical courses you practice by solving exercises like here's a differential equation so and so and what is the solution, and off you go calculating a solution. But it's not the point here. So it's really, chapter 3 is really I think about understanding. So it's careful reasoning, so I recommend to practice yourself, try to follow the reasoning and compare it to going to the gym to train your body. So if you go to the gym, you can lift heavy weights and you get stronger. You should realize that you have to repeat the exercise a few times, a few days, before you notice the effect. It gets easier. And also in the gym you take different kind of exercises. You can lift weights to get stronger, but you can also stretch through stretching to make your muscles more flexible. It's a very good thing to do, otherwise you get stiff. Same here. So we do in this chapter, we do this careful reasoning. It's like making your mind stronger, intense thinking. But we also do like change perspective, look at things from a different point of view. And I recommend to try to take notice of that. What are we doing? Are we intense reasoning or are we changing perspective and try to build mental pictures? It's a different thing. Both useful. But I believe if you take notice of what you're doing, it's easier to appreciate it. And it's easier for the mind to accept the training and indeed get trained and develop. Right? So chapter 3, the theory of general structure of second order ordinary linear differential equations. So our next topic for this course is second order differential equations, and we shall focus on linear ones. That is a substantial topic. Second order differential equations
are at the heart of the theory of planetary orbits, so the orbits of the planets around the Sun, which are called the Kepler orbits, and those are the same type of orbits that satellites have around Earth or planet. So they are of major interest to aerospace engineering, but that is for later in the course. The first slide is about the prior knowledge that is needed. I do presuppose that you master the theory of second order linear ordinary differential equations with constant coefficients. And those have been covered and examined as part of the calculus courses in the first year bachelor courses. So I do presuppose that you mastered the theory of that as far as it was covered in the first year, and that you certainly master the skill of solving them. So if you don't, make sure to refresh that knowledge and those skills on this item before you studying this material that is coming now. And to assist you in that, I have posted a separate do-it-yourself refresher slide pack on the website that outlines how to solve such equations, what they look like, and step by step how to solve them, what kind of solutions you get for all possible cases. And those are important anyway, because they form the core of the theory of vibrations, mass spring systems. So you have to master that anyway, because it is of vital importance for other courses in aerospace. And secondly, if you have that skill and have in your mind what those solutions look like, you will be able to recognize the different aspects of the theory that we will cover in this episode. So that being said, and if you have finished your practicing and refreshed your skills on linear equation with constant coefficients, follow me. So this is the outline of the plan. We will discuss the general form of second order linear differential equations concepts. And I mentioned some: linearity, non-linearity. And that is familiar from the first order differential equations. We have it here again. And then we will talk about homogeneous and non-homogeneous equations. And the target is to understand the structure of the solutions for second order linear ordinary differential equations. That has to do with the concept of superposition, which is the same as making linear combinations. And then once again, we will have a kind of a how many solutions question. So existence and uniqueness theorem, like we had for the first order equations. And that's a fundamental result that we shall build on. And after that, I will start talking about independence and basis. And there is something like what is called the Wronskian. And about that, there's Abel's theorem. And all that is ingredients for the theory of the general solution. Now, the Wronskian is a good thing to have at this part of this theory, but in episodes to come, when we learn some practical techniques to solve differential equations, the Wronskian plays a key role as a tool. So I do recommend to study that. Firstly, to understand the theory, but also to have clear understanding and memorize what the Wronskian is like so that you can use it for solution methods in that we will present in upcoming episodes. So that's the outline. And before we dive into this, I've highlighted some keywords here, and I would like to draw your attention to the fact that all these are familiar keywords from linear algebra. You should have heard these keywords in the linear algebra courses, and that is no coincidence. Really, structures that you learned in about vectors, vector spaces in linear algebra, really form the backbone for the structure of the solution for linear differential equations. And that is true for the theory that we will cover in this episode, and it will remain true for the remainder of the whole course. And that is one of the things that I announced in my announcement for my way of working, for my way of running this course. Because of the later topics, chapter 11 and chapter 10, I already start here with emphasizing this kind of backbone structure. So that is a very good investment to tie the whole course together. And it's also, it's a beautiful thing, so I hope you start to understand that if you really thoroughly study this material and then start to see the beauty of it. All right, so first the topic is, now let's see, what does a second order differential equation look like? Now, obviously, second order ordinary differential equation has the general form as is shown in the green box at this slide. So it involves the second order derivative y double prime at the left hand side, and at the right hand side there is a general function f that is a function of the independent variable t, the variable y, and could also be a function of the first order derivative of y. So that is very general indeed, and as was the case in first order differential equations, this is such a general concept that it is hardly specified, and indeed there is no such thing as a general solution method for second order differential equations in general. And we will focus on linear equations. And when is a second order differential equation called linear? Well, if that function f is of the form as shown, it is it contains only the dependent variable y as a first order to the first power, just terms proportional to y prime. It is strictly speaking not linear, that right hand side, because there is also allowed a function g that does not depend on y at all. So as far as y is concerned, that term is constant. It's also, strictly speaking, not a linear combination, because for linear combinations, as we learned in linear algebra, the coefficients need to be numbers, really constants. And here the coefficients of y and y prime are allowed to depend on time. And indeed, such general functions is what we shall address in chapter 5. Those are important. But that is what the general linear second order differential equation looks like. And it's often written in the form below, capital P, capital Q, capital R as functions of T, all coefficients of the y double prime, y prime and y. But note the subtle difference here. In the top form, the coefficients of y double prime is normalized to 1. And you could do that with the lower differential equation if you would just divide by p of t. And that is safe to do as long as p of t does nowhere take the value 0. That is, in the interval of t that you are interested in, there should be no zeros of that function p of t. In that case, the both equations are equivalent. The second one can be transformed to the first one by just dividing by capital P of T. But if capital P of T does have zeros, then they are not equivalent. And those equations are not to be excluded. There are even the more interesting ones, because zero of the coefficients of the highest order derivative does have consequences for the solutions, and those type of equations are central in applications, and that is the reason why we will really focus on those to figure out what consequences are if there are zeros in the leading coefficient. But that is the subject of chapter 5. So for this episode, we will focus on the slightly restricted case where the differential equation is really second order in each point. So the leading coefficient of y prime does not have a zero and can be rewritten in that top form. Now, I also mentioned here the familiar terminology from linear algebra. So we have an equation, and if we would in the lower one, if we would replace the right hand side, that function g of t, by zero, then we call the equation homogeneous. So that would be the homogeneous counterpart of that full equation. And if g of t is not zero, so the right hand side is not zero, then we call the equation non-homogeneous. And this is a first step to applying ideas from linear algebra, because also there we had homogeneous and non-homogeneous equations, and the solution spaces of that were related, and that relation we shall meet here again. So that terminology is chosen for good reasons. Yeah, all right. So there we go. Item 2. First step towards an understanding of the solution structure of a second order linear ordinary differential equation. I had ideas because there's no such thing for second order equations as a general solution method, like there is for first order equations. There's no such thing. It's a multi-stage approach, and the first steps that we shall take is to try to understand as much as we can of structures that we can discover and about the equation and about it, the behavior of solutions of it. So let's go for it. And a central concept of linearity, and this is really the very reason why these equations are called linear equations, comes through this theorem. I just have selected it from the textbook. This is a very central theorem for this type of equations. And it is the very reason why we call those equations linear equations. So it goes like this. If I have a linear homogeneous ordinary differential equation in the standard form as shown here, so that is a weighted sum of y double prime, y prime and y, but the weight coefficients are still allowed to depend on the independent variable t for time, say. So as such, that weighted sum is not really what we call linear combination, because a linear combination has weight coefficients that are numbers, constants, so things that do not depend on time. So this is not really a linear combination. So that is not the reason why we call this a linear equation. But the reason why we call it a linear equation is because its solutions have the property that if I would have two solutions, say y1 and y2, that are both solutions of that equation, if I would make a real linear combination of that, any linear combination, that is, I make a weighted sum of y1 and y2, and the weight coefficients of that combination, those are constants. And in this theorem, they are called C1 and C2. So that is a true linear combination of y1 and y2. And the theorem says, if y1 and y2 are solutions of that differential equation, then their linear combination is also a solution of the differential equation for all values of the constants C1 and C2, so any linear combination of those is also a solution. So let's see. Now this is so important that I want to prove it, analyze it and see why it is true. And that is also an opportunity to show you to introduce a new device that we shall use throughout this course again, and this is the first opportunity to really introduce that, and that is the idea of a linear operator. It's called L, and it's basically a shorthand for the left hand side of the equation if you compare that. So it is shown in the lower green box. So what is it? L is a mathematical device operation. It takes an argument, and that is the function y, and then it does several things and produces an output, and that is on the right hand side of the equal sign. So what do you have to do if you need to calculate L of y? Well, you take y and you multiply it by that function q of t. And then you take the derivative of y, and that you multiply by p of t. And then you take the second order derivative of y. And all that is added. And once you're done, you have calculated L of y. So it's kind of a procedure that we do. And we call that a linear operator, L. I will now take some steps to show you properties of that operation. And it is kind of similar to what we did when we first met the first order linear differential equation, and I started talking about the method of integrating factor. And that episode, we started saying, well, let's see if we can come up with some clever systematic way of solving that differential equation, and we started listing properties of ingredients, and I chose the most suitable ingredient that came to mind was, let us list the properties of the derivative operator. Now, for a second, and that proved to be successful, first list some properties of a relevant operation that you recognize that plays a key role. Now, that is a kind of a dead end if we would do that here, so believe me. But still, the approach was fruitful. So what do? We go after properties of that linear operation L, which is the whole of the left-hand side of the operation, of the differential equation. So here we go. I say, well, this L is a linear thing, is a linear operator, in the same sense as in the course on linear algebra, really. And that is shown in the right top green box. So here we go. So we have this L. And what do I mean with linear? I mean that if I substitute a weighted sum, a linear combination of two items, and then the result, if I evaluate, the result of that is the same weighted sum, same linear combination of the individual results that I would get. So what do we have to do to evaluate that? So here we go. L, and I substitute alpha is a number times u is a function. That's documented in the bottom slide. Function u of t. And beta is a number again, and v is a function of t again. So this is a linear combination of two functions, u and v, both functions of t. I substitute that in my linear operator and evaluate. So what do I have to do? Well, I have to substitute that argument, alpha u plus beta v, in the definition of L, and that is indicated in the top left hand side. So what do I have to do? I have to take the double derivative, and I have to take the first order derivative of alpha u plus beta v and multiply the result by p of t. And I have to take that argument alpha u plus beta v and multiply it by q, and all that has to be added up. And then I would have calculated L of alpha u plus beta v. Now those primes are derivatives, and those are linear. So I can distribute those over the plus. So let's see, the middle term. I can distribute to the prime, and I get alpha u prime plus beta v prime. That is just the linearity of the derivative operator, which is indicated by the prime here. And the first term is the same, but there's one prime left, but that can also be distributed. And then I get alpha u double prime plus beta v double prime. And the last term is easy, because I don't have to do anything. And in the next step, we sort. We sort by u and v, and factor out alpha and beta, the numbers. So let's see, I have a alpha u double prime here, that goes here, is the alpha. There's another u term, u prime here, and an alpha times p. So I take alpha out, and p times u prime goes here. And then there's another u here, with alpha times q. So q times u goes here, alpha I take out of these parentheses, this one closes here. And these are all the u's, if you scan. All the u's are scattered here. And now the v's. So I have a v double prime here times beta. So it goes here. V prime is here times beta and times this p. So the p is here times that v prime, and the beta goes out of this parenthesis that closes here. And the last v term is here times beta and times q. Now, beta is here and q is over here. If you compare this line, if you compare what is between these parentheses to the definition of L, which is in the top box over here, you see that what is in this parenthesis is just L with U substituted for Y. If I substitute for Y U here, I get exactly this expression. And if I would substitute V for Y, I get exactly the expression that is in the parenthesis here. Now, if I use that as a notation, I get this result. Alpha times L for U plus, that is this plus, beta times L for V. See? So what do I get if I substitute in L a linear combination that is a weighted sum with numbers as weight coefficients of two functions U and V? I get as a result the same weighted sum and the same weight coefficients, that is the same linear combination of the individual results that I would get if I substitute this U and that V into that L here. And that really makes L into a linear combination, a linear operation, in the very sense that you learned in the course on linear algebra. And in linear algebra, it was this very property that was at the core and the basis of very many theorems that you learned in that course. And the same is true here for linear differential equations. And that is the very reason why we call differential equations that have this kind of a left-hand side linear. That is because this operation has this linearity property. So very well. So I've demonstrated that once and for all, that left-hand side is a linear operation in terms of the function that you substitute in it, the function y. Now, given that, back to our theorem, which says if I have two solutions of a homogeneous differential equation, a linear homogeneous differential equation, then any linear combination of those solutions is also a solution. Now, the proof is very easy. It is really once you know that that left-hand side is a linear operator, and that is indicated here. So the differential equation is really nothing else than saying L of y is zero. I could just replace this by L of y. So the equation is really just saying L of y is zero. Now, we have two solutions, Ly and Y1 and Y2, and we are supposed to investigate if this linear combination is also a solution. That means if we substitute that linear combination into that L, if that gives zero. Well, we just established that L is linear. So if I substitute a linear combination into that L, the result of that will be the same linear combination, so this weighted sum with the same coefficients of the individual results, substituting y1 into L plus y2 substituted into L. But y1 and y2 are solutions. That was what the whole theorem is about. I have two solutions. Now that means, because the equation is nothing else than saying L, y is zero, and if that satisfies you of a solution, well, if y1 is a solution, then L of y1 apparently is zero, and a constant times zero is zero. And y2 is also a solution, so L of y2, that means y2 substituted into L, is zero, because y2 is a solution. So the result of all that is 0 plus 0, really, and that is 0. So it comes in a few steps very easy. It follows very easily from the fundamental property of that left-hand side of the differential equation and our observation that that itself is a linear operator, then it follows immediately in very easy steps, but fundamental steps, that then any linear combination of solutions is also a solution. So that's an important result. It means that if you have two solutions, then you can form an infinite amount of them by just making superpositions, which is just another word for making linear combinations. And that allows us to use the terminology that you are used to in linear algebra. The set of all linear combinations of two vectors is called the span of those vectors. And the same terminology applies here. The set of all linear combinations of two functions is the span of those two functions. The span of the set of those two functions. So the curly braces indicate set. So this is a set of that contains two individual functions, y1 and y2. And the set of all linear combinations of those is called the span of that set. So we introduce and we meet the notion of spanning a set of functions, and it is exactly the same as you saw in linear algebra, for example, the textbook of Lay on linear algebra. And such a set is called a vector space if it satisfies certain conditions, and that I will show you on the next slide. And on purpose, this slide I prepared by just making a photograph of my own copy of the Book of Lay in this introduction page of chapter 4. Lay presents the axioms of vector algebra. And it says, well, a vector space is a set of objects, non-empty, and we call them vectors. No matter what they are, we call them vectors if we can do a number of things with them. We can add them up, so there's addition. We can multiply them by numbers. We shall usually use real numbers, but complex numbers is also possible. And provided that these two operations, the addition of vectors and the multiplication of them by numbers, obey these 10 rules. And these are called axioms, so they cannot be proven. They are posed as the laws of vector algebra, the rule of vector spaces. So let's see, if there is two vectors, it must be possible to add them up. And we agree that if we add two vectors up, that just means we write u plus v, then the result is still a vector. And that rule number two says that addition is commutative. So if I add v to u, I get the same result as adding u to v. And it is also associative, rule number three. If I first add u and v and then add w to the result, I get the same as if I add first w to v and then add u. So the order of the addition is of no influence to the result that you get in the end. There must be a zero vector written zero. That has the property that if I add it to any other vector, then I get that vector itself. And there must be a negative, rule number five. If I have a vector, there must be a minus vector minus u. If there's a vector u, there must be a vector minus u, such that if I add those up, I get zero. It must be possible for any vector to multiply by a number, c, and we just write c times u, such that that the result is still a vector, so it is still in the space that you are working with. It must be such that the multiplication of any sum of a vector is the same as the addition of the multiplied individual vectors. In other words, rule number 7 says the multiplication by number distributes over the addition of vectors. Rule number 8 says the multiplication of a vector by a number distributes over the addition of numbers. And rule number 9 says the multiplication by numbers is associative. The order in which I do that doesn't matter. And there must be a number 1, and if I multiply any vector by 1, then the vector remains unchanged. So these are really very familiar rules of calculation with vectors. And there are the axioms of vector algebra, and that means that all the proofs that you saw in linear algebra can be derived from these 10 rules. So given these 10 rules, all the theorems in linear algebra can be derived, can be proven, purely on basis of this. So no matter what the vectors really are, but the theorems all follows strictly from these calculation rules only. That is the meaning of the word axioms. Now if you check these calculation rules, you will see that they also apply if u and v would not be column vectors, as you were used to in linear algebra, but if we would substitute functions of t or functions of x for those, if you would substitute sine functions and cosine functions and exponential functions for these, all these rules actually apply. You can multiply them by numbers, you can add them up, and these calculation rules just apply to the calculus of function, to the algebra that we usually do, the calculations that we usually do with functions. So that's promising. Probably this calculus just applies. And in that sense, functions will behave as vectors. Now you might wonder, so what? What is the big harvest here? What is the big advantage? Well, that means that we will be able to visualize vector spaces, and we had the first example, the solutions of homogeneous second order differential equation are such that you can use them to span a linear space. And the calculus that plays a role there is the same calculus as the calculus for vector spaces, and that allows you to visualize the structure of those solution sets in the same way that you can visualize column vectors by vector diagrams. And that is just not just an analogy, it really shows kind of point of view, perspective on the situation. So that is very useful, and we will use that throughout the course, starting now, to get used to it. But later it is more and more, we add more and more and more ingredients from linear algebra will enter the picture, and you get a more and more detailed picture of the structure of solutions of linear differential equations. It's all based on this. So one example of that, visualizing the solution space of a linear ordinary differential equation as a vector space, well, this slide revisits the results that we had for first order linear differential equations. The equation again is revisited in the top left hand green box here. So we have the general form of a linear ordinary differential equation, y prime plus an arbitrary function p times y equals the right hand side g of t. And then this is our theory of the integrating factor, and the result of that was the general solution that is shown here. We had this integrating factor, and using that we could solve that linear differential equation. The solution looked like this, but I rewrite it slightly here by saying, well, this 1 over the in 1 over mu, I call function v of t to clarify the structure. And that means if I take this fraction apart, I have plus c over mu is c times that v. And c is the arbitrary constant of integration. And then the rest, this part, I call p. So this plus is this plus. Since there is a function, and the degree of freedom in that solution is the scaling by an arbitrary constant. Now, just scaling is just is the most simple linear combination that you can make. It's the linear combinations that you can make out of one vector. I can multiply it by a number. There's no addition because I have just one vector. So this underlined green part of the general solution for y, these linear combinations of all is all linear combinations of that part v. Now, what I now can do is make a sketch, a geometrical picture of what that looks like. And once again, this picture is a photograph of the book of Lay. It's not a book on differential equations, it is a picture from a book of linear algebra. But the point that I want to make here is we start solving a linear differential equation in this box. The general structure of that solution looks like this. I only rewrite it a little bit, and then I can take a picture from a book on linear algebra to make a sketch of what the structure of this solution is. Here's a vector v. And what I can do with vector v is multiply it by a number c. And that is exactly what happens here in this part of the solution. And after I have done that, I can add to it a constant function that has no degree of freedom. It's a given fixed thing. And I add that to get the total right hand side, and in this diagram that looks like this. I have a v, I scale it by a number, and then I add another vector. And it goes in a different direction because this p itself is not a scaled version of v. So p goes in a different direction. And this is my end result. Now what I'm allowed to do is vary this constant c. So I could scale this vector v to any length that I like, but after that I'm always adding this same vector p according to this formula. So the results that I get are on this blue line. That means the direction of the general solution of a non-homogeneous equation in linear algebra, that is what is indicated here in the top, a non-homogeneous equation in linear algebra, the general structure of that has the same direction and the same dimension as the solution of that same of this equation that I would get if I replaced the right hand side by zero, because that is the CV. And that is also the case here. If I replace, if I form the homogeneous differential equation by replacing g of t by zero, then the solution would here be the integral of zero, primitive function of zero, that would be a constant. So I would add to this c a constant. But it doesn't, but c is arbitrary. So that really doesn't change anything relevant. So I might as well then take that primitive equal to zero. And it means that I might as well, if this equation is replaced by a homogeneous equation, the solution really reduces to just this and p becomes zero. Now, same here in linear algebra. The homogeneous, the solution of the homogeneous equation is given by that line there. So what was the relation in linear algebra between the solution of a homogeneous equation and a non-homogeneous equation? Well, the general solution of the non-homogeneous equation here, the blue line, is a particular solution, one particular solution that solves the non-homogeneous equation, plus the general solution of the homogeneous equation, which is this straight line, and the general solution has that constant of integration, that free parameter. Now, same here for these linear differential equations. The general structure of the solution of a first order differential equation is a particular solution that takes care of the right hand side, and the general solution of the homogeneous equation, which is this one, that is what you get if you solve the differential, the homogeneous differential equation. Okay, you get this. See, so the structure of solutions in linear algebra and linear differential equations is really the same, and you can make these diagrams to get a kind of a pictorial visualization that helps you to understand the structure of the solution. That will be of enormous help to understand why what we do in chapter 5 is actually sufficient. You have sufficient building blocks, all based on this idea. All right, and this is a first example of it that it's also successful in first order differential equations. Now that is inspiring, because what could we do with linear solutions, with the solution spaces for linear equations in linear algebra? Well, they were subspaces, and a subspace had a basis. That is, once I have established the general solution, I can say, well, this is the span of a basis, and I can even choose a convenient basis. Right? You can choose many different bases all spanning the same subspace. So that is a very useful thing to know, and maybe that concept applies also here to the differential equations. Maybe we don't have to really calculate all the solutions of a differential equation, a linear one. Maybe having a couple of one that form a basis is sufficient. And that is what we will go after. And as I said, throughout the course, more and more structures will surface that are familiar and applicable from linear algebra. All right. Back to the ordinary differential equations. So let me summarize where we stand. If we study a second order linear homogeneous differential equation, and if we would have two solutions for that,
say y1 and y2, then any linear combination of those two is also a solution of that differential equation. And by a linear combination, we mean a weighted sum in which the weight coefficients are numbers. So those do not depend on the independent variable in the differential equation. We can then use the language that you learned in the course of linear algebra. If I make a set of all linear combinations of two elements, then we call that the span of those two elements. So in this case, if I have two solutions of a linear second order homogeneous differential equation, say y1 and y2, then the span of the set that contains y1 and y2 consists of solutions of that differential equation. That means all the elements in the span of y1 and y2 are also solutions of that differential equation. So that is where we stand so far. Now, and that raises the question, if vice versa, it would be possible to write all the solutions of the differential equation in that form. So would it be possible to say all solutions, the set of all solutions of a homogeneous second order linear differential equation is really equal to the span of two solutions? So that has various aspects. The one is it possible in the first place to represent the solution of a second order homogeneous linear differential equation as the span of two functions? And if the answer to that would be yes, then the next question is, would there be additional conditions on those two functions? How to conceive the set of all solutions of a given linear second order ordinary differential equation, we again bring in an existence and uniqueness theorem for initial value problems. It goes like this. Again, we consider a differential equation, second order linear differential equation in standard form. That means that the coefficient of the highest order derivative, the double derivative of y, is 1. What is essential is that the coefficient of the highest order derivative does not take the value 0 anywhere on an interval of interest. Furthermore, in that form, all the coefficients and functions that occur in the differential equation are required to be continuous. And then the theorem says, if on the interval I Maar pick a value for the independent variable, say t for time, say. I pick a value on the horizontal axis. Then I may specify the value that I want the solution y to take for that value of t, as well as the derivative, which is the slope of the curve, and then there will be exactly one solution of the differential equation that takes that specific value with that specific value for the derivative. So if you would conceive the solution as a curve, I may specify on each point on the horizontal axis, I pick a point, and at that point I specify the value and the slope that I want the solution curve to take at that point, and then the existence and uniqueness theorem for initial value problems for second order linear differential equations tells us that there will be exactly one solution that satisfies those initial conditions. Exactly one. So that gives us indeed an answer to a kind of an as many, how many question. How many solutions does that differential equation have? Or in other words, could you give me a description of the set of all solutions? Well, if I would want to trace out the set of all possible solutions, it would be sufficient to say, well, I trace all possible choices on the horizontal axis, and then I take all possible values that the function could take there, and for each of those, all possible slopes, and that for each such choice there will exist a solution, and there will be precisely one. And then you see how ingenious this approach is, because that really captures all solutions of the differential equation. And that is because if there would be any solution on that interval, it should definitely take a value and a slope. But then the theorem says, well, if it does take a value and a slope, then there is only one solution. So that is already included in the description that we set up by tracing out all values and all slopes. In that way we build up an overview of solutions that are guaranteed to exist and that are characterized by those two specified initial values. But then those must be all, because each solution must take a value and must have a slope. And then the theorem says that there is only one, because the solutions that go through a point with a certain value and a certain slope are unique. So that is already included in my overview. So indeed, an existence and uniqueness statement for initial value problems for a given differential equation indeed gives a complete overview of the solutions. And therefore I can say it gives an overview of all solutions of the differential equation. And hence, the answer to the question, what does the set of solutions for the differential equation on itself look like? The set of all solutions of the differential equation by itself, what does it look like? Well, that is exactly the set of all solutions of all possible initial value problems of that type, and that is, I may specify for point of choice on the horizontal axis, a value and a slope, and no more. Because if you would specify more, then you run into the risk that there would perhaps no longer be a solution.
We now have all the ingredients to tackle our pending question, which still is the following. Would it be possible, and if so, under what conditions, to span the general solution of a linear, second-order, homogeneous, ordinary differential equation by a set of, say, two well-chosen solutions, say y1 and y2? To address this question, we reason as follows. On basis of the theorems that we gathered and discussed so far, we start recollecting the superposition theorem, which guarantees that if we have two solutions, say y1 and y2, then any linear combination of these is also a solution. Any such linear combination would be a function y of t, and it would be equal to a weighted sum of y1 and y2, with weight coefficients c1 and c2, c1 and c2 being arbitrary constants. Because of the linearity of the derivative operation, the derivative of such a function y would then be the same linear combination of the derivatives of y1 and y2. Now, again, this function y of t is certainly a solution of the differential equation, as long as y1 and y2 are so. But now we face the question whether or not all solutions of the differential equations are of this form, for some well-chosen, but fixed, solutions y1 and y2. To test this, we require that this function y of t can meet all initial value conditions that are allowed by the existence and uniqueness theorem for initial value problems. This theorem tells us that a unique solution will exist for any initial value problem that supplements the differential equation with a prescription of the value of the function y, say y0, and of its derivative, say y0 prime, at any sound selected value t0 for t. Moreover, as we have discussed, these are all solutions of the differential equation itself. And hence we check if our function y of t can meet any arbitrarily posed initial condition of this type. To do so, we impose these initial conditions to our function y, and write them down. This renders the equations halfway down the slide, at the left-hand side. These equations are perhaps more comprehensive if we write them in matrix notation. This matrix form appears at the right-hand side of the slide. These are equations for the constants C1 and C2, for these were arbitrary and hence their values are undetermined, so far. Now, for our function, y of t, to be able to meet any of our arbitrarily imposed initial conditions, this matrix equation should have a solution for any instance of its right-hand side. Then, from linear algebra, we use the result that this is so, if and only if the matrix is invertible. A practical, necessary and sufficient condition for this is that the determinant of the matrix is non-zero. This particular determinant is shown on the slide in the lower right green box. It is known as the Wronskian. The Wronskian is written symbolically as a function capital W that takes two functions, here y1 and y2, as arguments. Because these functions depend on t0 here, the resulting expression for the Wronskian will also be a function of t0. A summary of the result that we have thus established can be taken for a theorem, which is then as follows. If y1 and y2 are two solutions of a second order, linear, homogeneous, ordinary differential equation that can be written in standard form, while the coefficients of the differential equation are continuous on some open interval, and provided the Wronskian of y1 and y2 does not vanish at any point t0 in the interval, then the family of functions, consisting of all possible superpositions of y1 and y2, includes every solution of the differential equation. The set containing the two functions y1 and y2 is then called a fundamental set of solutions. The span of this set is called the general solution of the differential equation. In the language of linear algebra, we can say that the general solution has the structure of a two-dimensional vector space, or, using a synonym, we can say that it forms a two-dimensional linear space. We say that the functions y1 and y2 are linearly independent. Furthermore, again in the language of linear algebra, we can say that the fundamental set of solutions forms a basis for the general solution. Indeed, the fundamental set consists of independent elements, and it spans a linear space, and the combination of precisely these two properties makes it a basis for the linear space. Now, the condition that the Wronskian of y1 and y2 must not vanish at any point t0 in the interval may look harsh and intimidating, but here we can call upon a theorem known as Abel's theorem for relief. Abel's theorem is worth knowing anyway, because it is of great practical value supplementing a method for solving non-homogeneous differential equations that we shall meet soon, in upcoming episodes. The proof of Abel's theorem is straightforward and not very difficult, once you know how to get started. It provides good exercise in doing symbolic calculations with linear differential equations. We shall do this in a little dedicated episode, however, and we shall just quote the theorem here and take advantage of it. In short, Abel's theorem tells us that the Wronskian that we have to consider will be equal to an arbitrary constant of integration, say c, times the exponential function of minus a primitive of the function p. The coefficient of y prime in a linear second-order differential equation in standard form. Because an exponential function never takes the value zero on the real axis, Abel's theorem implies that a Wronskian can only be zero if the constant c is equal to zero. And from this we may conclude, immediately, that a Wronskian is either identically equal to zero, that is, it would be equal to zero for all values of t, or else it is never zero, so for no real value of t. In this light, the condition for two solutions y1 and y2 of a linear, second-order, homogeneous, ordinary differential equation to be linearly independent, is far easier to check than it may have seemed at first glance. Indeed, as soon as we detect only a single point in the interval of interest where the Wronskian is non-zero, we're done. for then the Wronskian will not vanish anywhere in the interval, and we will have established a fundamental set of solutions.
All right, thank you, Amy.
You're most welcome. My pleasure.
So almost there. And let's finish this, but so almost there, but not quite. So far we have concentrated on homogeneous linear differential equations of second order. So homogeneous meaning we have zero at the right hand side of the equation. And so far we learned that it would be possible in practice to span the general solution of such a homogeneous linear ordinary differential equation by establishing a so-called fundamental set consisting of, say, two solutions of the homogeneous equation y1 and y2, provided that they are independent, and we have a criterion for that being that the Wronskian of those two functions should not be zero anywhere in the interval. And by virtue of Abel's theorem, that is less harsh than it may seem at first glance, because for the Wronskian to be nowhere zero in the interval, it is a sufficient condition that it is not zero at some point in the interval. So that might in practice be quite easy to check and confirm. So that is how far we got, and it's all about the homogeneous equation. But now what remains is, what about a non-homogeneous ordinary linear differential equation of second order again? And non-homogeneous means there is a non-zero term, say a function g of t in the right hand side of the equation. So the slide here gives the overview. In the top green box we have the theorem that we established so far for the homogeneous equation, and I marked that by capital H, and that is the homogeneous counterpart of a non-homogeneous equation that is in the lower green box. The question is, what would be the structure of the general solution of such a non-homogeneous equation? And then again we can use insights that were established in the course on linear algebra in the first bachelor year. Very early in the course, actually, you can find the theory and the proof of that even very early in the book of Lay that we used for that course. It is in section 1.5, and it's also exercise 25 of that section, at least in the edition of the book that I have. The idea is that all you need to find the general solution of a non-homogeneous linear equation is one particular solution of the non-homogeneous equation, and it doesn't matter which one it is. It will have many solutions. It will have an infinite amount of solutions, indeed. But it doesn't matter which one it is, but you need only one example, and we call that a particular solution. So any particular solution of the non-homogeneous equation will do, because then the general solution of the non-homogeneous equation can be achieved by adding to that particular solution the general solution of the homogeneous equation. And that we have, because that can be spanned by a fundamental set. Well, the proof actually you could do yourself, because it was done very early in the course, in the bachelor course on linear algebra. But let's very briefly revisit that. It goes like this. So we have a non-homogeneous linear ordinary differential equation, and I've abbreviated once again using my linear operator L that takes y as an argument. And it is a non-homogeneous equation that is on the top left in this slide. And it's non-homogeneous because it has a right-hand side function g of t. And then we form the homogeneous counterpart of that. So the homogeneous equation is the same linear operator L, but the right-hand side has been replaced by zero. That is why we call it homogeneous. Now, to be proven now is that if I would have any solution of the non-homogeneous equation, let's say yp2, any particular solution, that can be written as a particular solution yp1 that I had in the first place. It doesn't matter which one it is, but we assume we have one particular solution yp1. And now we have to prove or demonstrate that yp2 can always be constructed from yp1 by just adding a solution from the homogeneous equation. Well, let's see. We start by just substituting those two particular solutions into our linear operator L and take the difference. And then what else should we do than take advantage of the knowledge that we have about L, which is that it is linear. And that means that L distributes over the minus, and that is what we do. But then the other way around, to go from the first line to the second line in the green box. And the next thing that we use is that both yp2 and yp1 are solutions of the non-homogeneous equation. That means if we substitute those functions into L and evaluate the linear operator, it will give the right-hand side of the non-homogeneous equation, which is the function g of t. So we write that down and take the difference. Now, because both give g of t, the difference is zero, of course. And if we now combine the second line of this little derivation with the last one, we get the result that the difference of yp2 and yp1, so the difference of two particular solutions, and if we substitute that into L, you get zero, and that means that that difference is a solution of the homogeneous equation, which is labeled here by the label capital H. But that means if yp2 minus yp1 is a solution of the homogeneous equation, then it is in the span of a fundamental set. Now, we denote that fundamental set by y1 and y2, and that means that the difference of yp2 and yp1 is in the span of those fundamental solutions. And that means that there is some linear combination of y1 and y2 that is equal to the difference of yp2 and yp1. And that is what I've written here. Now, what remains to be done is to put yp1 to the other side, and the result is yp2, so the second, any second particular solution of the non-homogeneous equation is really equal to a particular solution that we assumed we had, yp1, plus some solution of the homogeneous equation. And we should emphasize any alternative particular solution, or any alternative solution of the non-homogeneous equation, here denoted by yp2, can be constructed from a particular solution that you chose in the first place by adding to that some linear combination, some suitable linear combination of the fundamental solutions of the homogeneous equation. So some solution of the homogeneous equation. And that concludes the proof.
If I may add something, make absolutely sure to notice that this little proof does actually in no way refer to the fact that we once introduced linear operator L as a differential operator. Indeed, the derivation on this sheet does not depend on L representing a differential operator at all. As far as properties of L are involved, the proof really only depends on the fact that L is linear. The proof itself can indeed be found in elementary textbooks on linear algebra. Chances are that you have seen or done this proof yourself with matrices in mind. If so, you should now come to realize that the structure that we have revisited here doesn't refer to matrix calculus either. It is merely about linearity. In fact, in many upcoming episodes of this course, we shall encounter similar situations. Indeed, many things, if not the majority of them, that we shall learn to understand about linear differential equations, we shall understand in terms of structures that essentially belong to linear algebra. But they usually have nothing essential to do with matrix calculus.
Thank you, Amy. Where would I be without
you? You just couldn't do this without me. And you know it.
All right, now let me summarize then. So the slide gives an overview. And now at the top we start with the task how to find the general solution of a non-homogeneous differential equation, a linear one. Well, we would start with finding two solutions, y1 and y2 of the homogeneous equation. And then we would make sure that there exists a point t0 in the interval of interest such that the Wronskian of those two functions y1 and y2 would not be zero at that point t0. Because it would then follow that y1 and y2 would form a basis, we call that a fundamental set of solutions for the homogeneous equation, which is here denoted by two stars. So that the general solution of the homogeneous equation would be the set of arbitrary superpositions, arbitrary linear combinations of y1 and y2. So keep notice that c1 and c2 are really constants. They are arbitrary, but once chosen, they are fixed numbers. Next, we would need to find only a single particular solution of the non-homogeneous equation, here denoted by a star. And we call the particular solution here yp. That would also be a function of t, and it would provide an example of a solution of the non-homogeneous equation. And then the general solution of the non-homogeneous equation star would be that particular solution, and added to that an arbitrary combination, an arbitrary linear combination of y1 and y2. So the structure of the general solution of a non-homogeneous linear second order ordinary differential equation also has two constants of integration. And finally, if initial conditions were prescribed at some point in the interval of interest and the Wronskian would be non-zero there, then C1 and C2 can always be chosen such that the general solution is adjusted so as to meet those initial conditions. So that is the general plan of what you would have to do to solve a non-homogeneous ordinary linear second order differential equation, but that is only the general plan. We have not discussed at all how to find those functions, the particular solutions or the fundamental solutions of the homogeneous equation. We have not discussed at all how to construct those. But as I announced in my foreword, to construct those functions y1 and y2 in general is something that we will learn in chapter 5, and those can be considerable calculations. So it will take a couple of lectures to come before we get there. And in the now following lectures, we will first concentrate on constructing particular solutions, assuming that we already would have y1 and y2, so solutions of the homogeneous equation. See? But as I announced in the foreword, because those can be considerable calculations, it's good to have a plan. And it's good to know that we need only these three building blocks to solve the general non-homogeneous equations. We need a YP, a Y1, and a Y2. How to do that, we will learn in the upcoming lectures. But so far, we have at least a general plan, and we know what we need to provide the general solution of a linear second order ordinary differential equation. All right. So at least we have made some progress. We have a plan.
Now that we have revealed the structure of general solutions of second order, linear, ordinary differential equations, we may visualize this structure by the same technique as we could apply to visualize the structure of a two-dimensional solution of a matrix equation. For the structures are essentially the same. For a 3x3 matrix, a two-dimensional solution of an equation, A, X, equals B, could be visualized by three-dimensional graphics. This is done in the following animation. Because the structure of a general solution of a second-order, linear, ordinary differential equation is essentially the same, this visualization may help us to imagine it. The two red arrows correspond to fundamental solutions of the differential equation. Their span is denoted by the green plane. This plane therefore visualizes the general solution of an homogeneous equation. Note that this plane contains the origin. This is the point from where the vectors originate. The blue arrow corresponds to a particular solution of the non-homogeneous equation. It supports the upper green plane, which represents the general solution of the non-homogeneous equation. Note that, indeed, all points of the upper plane can be reached by adding some vector from the lower plane to the blue vector. Note furthermore that the fundamental solutions, denoted by the red vectors, are by no means unique. Indeed, any set of two linearly independent vectors taken from the lower plane would also span the lower plane, and could serve as a basis for it, so as a fundamental set. Likewise, any vector that would support the upper plane could serve as a particular solution. Well, that should be it for now. Let's call it an episode. My pleasure.